Okay, well, welcome everyone.
Welcome. Good morning.
Good morning. Nice to see so many familiar faces. Usually I ask, how many people know about the SBDC? Show of hands. Look at that, turn around. Look at how many people know about the SBDC. Brings me a great deal of pleasure knowing that. I've been actually with the SBDC going on 9 years now. So part of my job when I came to the SBDC was to do outreach. So obviously I've been doing my job because so many of you are here. My name, for those of you who don't know who I am, is Jacqueline Mejias Fuertes. I am the regional director of the Small Business Development Center here at Brookdale Community College. So thank you. I thank you all for being patient with us this morning. I know that there was an accident. And like I said, we have a full room, so we were really trying to make sure that we got as many people in so there'll be minimal interruption. That being said, for those of you who do not know about the SBDC, we are a nationwide organization. We're actually called America's SBDC. Here in the state of New Jersey, we are a network of 12 centers strategically located throughout the state of New Jersey. We cover all 21 counties. What does that mean for you? If you have a business in Monmouth or Ocean County, you get to see us. If you have a business in one of the other counties, then it's up to you to decide which SBDC you want to work with. We all provide similar services, and it goes with our mission. Our mission is pretty simple. It's to assist small business owners as well as entrepreneurs with starting and growing their business. And the reason we do this is because for economic development. If someone starts a business, they're creating a job for themselves and for others. So that's pretty much why we're here. We are funded in part by the SBA. For those of you who do not know who the SBA is, it's the Small Business Administration. Someone asked today, who is funding this program? And I said, your tax dollars. Why? Because SBA, being a federal agency, receives funding from your tax dollars. So we always love to say, what we bring to you is your tax dollars at work. The services that we provide, which is through education and one-on-one confidential counseling, which is at no cost at any time, is brought to you by your tax dollars. So you've already paid for this. My job is to tell you, take advantage of it. This particular center has been around for over 35 years. It was part of the pilot program that started the SBDC here in New Jersey. Our headquarters is out of Rutgers University in Newark, the business school. So, as I was saying, regarding what we're here to offer you, our job is really to see what way we can help you. I'm happy to report that my particular center, because I'm very, I own it, as well as my team, we're very innovative. We look on to you to determine what are the services that we should bring to you. Some of them are steadfast because it's the foundation and you need to have the education. And at other times, it's more on what's happening with technology, which is pretty much what you're gonna get today. It's all on social media. Yes, you have to have some knowledge of it because it's not really for totally beginners, but it is at a beginner's level. It's about developing a strategy for yourself, for your business, in order for it to succeed. Now, if you want to receive counseling, because some of you didn't sign up fast enough, that's why I always say, make sure you're on our list for your newsletter. So this way, as soon as we put it out, you can see what we're providing and sign up quickly. Because as you can see, we have a full room today. The session for this afternoon, we ended up with so many calls for people asking to get into that session, and it couldn't happen. So sign up for our newsletter, follow us on Facebook, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram to get information immediately so you can sign up. In order to receive additional counseling, which we provide at no cost to you, as I mentioned earlier, at any time, there's one thing you have to do. If you are not a current client of the SBDC, I need you to visit our website, which you have a handout with the address, which is mosbdc.com. Free counseling requests online. Complete the form. It'll take you less than a minute to complete. We will receive it electronically. We will give you a call within 24 to 48 hours. No questions at the moment, sorry. So all you have to do is complete it. We'll call you up. Anyone who calls you does have the information that could assist you and move you along through the process. Also on our website, we have two new locations, new business, existing businesses. See where you fall within the category, go to that, drop down the menu, answer the questions. It'll help the process along a lot quicker. That's a new point that we added to the website to kind of facilitate the process and make it easier for you as well. So I don't want to keep on going because I know Lisa has a jam-packed session for this morning. As you can see by the handout, it's 54 pages. So you are going to get a great deal of information. Because of the number of individuals here, questions will not take place. So if you do have any questions, when you came in, there was a form you had to complete, an attendee form. On it, it said if you wanted counseling, you were supposed to check that off. Even if you decide after you take the workshop you don't want counseling, we'll call you. You could tell us, you know what, I'm not interested. And it's fine. Okay? So remember, in order to receive our information, our website, we update it all the time. Everything that you're learning here, we implement through our office as well. And you can tell that it works. Look at the room. It's nice and full. So with that, I just want to bring over Lisa, our expert social media consultant and president of LK Corporate Advisors. Phenomenal at her job. Lisa and I have been working together now going on for about 4 years, 5 years?
Five years.
And, you know, I was innovative enough to know what our business community needed. I found Lisa. She helped blossom into this huge program. One other thing. You received the packet. The packet has information on the various programs that we offer. There's a training program evaluation form. I need everyone, and I mean everyone, to complete this form when you complete the workshop. And that's when you go after module 2, before you leave, complete this form. My team will be here to collect it. Okay, simple as that. And the reason we need this is, remember I mentioned earlier, we are funded by SBA. We get audited. They want to see what we're doing. This provides information for them as to how many attendees came in. They're not interested in your name. They're really interested in the demographics and how we did with our session. And it also helps us in order to improve the programs that we're bringing to you. Okay, so with that, I give you Lisa Kanda.
Good morning. What a wonderful group to have here. And that tells me something. Tells me we need social media, doesn't it?
Yes.
This is pretty important stuff. So let's start with, how many of you are using social media right now for your business? For your business. This is what we're all about, for your business. Okay? Almost everybody. Okay. Of those of you that are using it for your business, how many of you are finding success? And by success, I mean you're actually getting clients, getting business, all that good stuff. Okay, so a few more. Okay, that's impressive. That's very impressive. Because about 10 years ago, I was working in the corporate world, working with lawyers, believe it or not, which is even more painful. And social media was just beginning to be talked about, just beginning. You know, LinkedIn was pretty much the one that was out there. Facebook really hadn't transitioned into a business opportunity. It was still being used on universities and just starting from a personal standpoint. And I remember I was involved personally. You know, I'm a guru. I mean, I love this stuff. I'm a tech head. I can't tell you that. You know, it's fun stuff to me. So I'm doing it. I'm trying to tell this law firm, we need to be doing social media 10 years ago. And they're looking at me like I have five heads. So when I started my business in 2008, what did you think I did? I used social media. Of course I did. How do you think I was able to grow my business? Through social media. How did I get to the point where I have a knowledge base of where I am today? by learning about social media. Because as business owners, whether you're teaching it like I am or you're using it as a tool for your business, you need to learn how to use these tools. It's not going to go away. I think evidence has shown, any of us that had our heads in the sand even 3-4 years ago know that it's not going to go away, right? If you're looking in your rearview mirror and you're thinking, but I don't want to, can't we do things the way we've always done them, right? That's not going to get you anywhere anymore. Not to say traditional marketing doesn't work. I'm not saying throw in the towel on old ways. I'm saying you can't keep looking back. You have to be looking forward. And it's moving at an extremely rapid pace. Right? So as business owners, we need to keep up as best as we can. And the way we do that is with a strategy. Because you can't do it all. So a social media GPS is a way to create that strategy, that blueprint, that roadmap we're talking about. So we wouldn't even be talking about GPS 10 years ago. We can't live without GPS now, right? GPS, Global Positioning System. You didn't know what that meant, okay? We live by that. So what do when we use our GPS? When we use our GPS, we put our destination in, correct? And usually, if we're in our car or we're using our smartphone, it knows where we are already, correct? So we are here, and here's where we're going. And it takes us there. So part of the conversation today is about where are you now, and where do you need to go? Have you even set that destination yet? And if you have it, you need to. Because without a roadmap, you'll never get there. Does that make sense? So I started out just like you did. You can do this. Some of you are already having some success. You can continue to do it. Those of you who are brand new to this or struggling with it, you can do this. It's not that scary. As Jacqueline mentioned, there are numerous programs here at the SBDC that provide you with 3 hours of intensive training in specific topics on top of it. Some of you have already participated in some of these because I see my students in the room. So if you haven't taken advantage of those programs, this is just to whet your appetite. And I'm going to mention some of the other programs that you can get more detail in as we go through the program. But clearly, you want to take advantage of getting more in-depth information and knowledge on how to do this, okay? So there was a day, and I'm going to date myself, when this is what the scenario used to be like, right? We had one TV, the family gathered around the TV, and we watched TV. I know, some of us are like, when was that? We always had a TV in our room. But this is what it used to be. And then now we are at the Mad Men. I mean, that was the Mad Men mentality. So basically, the 1950s, it was the advertiser's dream decade. Why? Post-war economy. Yeah, people were ready to start buying. Consumerism, they've been you know, on rations for so long. And the massive reach of TV was what did it all. Massive reach of TV. And before I forget, because I did forget this, if you see this little hashtag down here, NJ Small Biz, live tweets are going out as I speak with the hashtag. So if you are on Twitter, I encourage it. If you're on Facebook, please post. That's the one way you can use your phone today, this device. We're going to talk about a lot about this device. So if you're on Facebook or Twitter, we highly recommend, tell people you're here, share the knowledge, let them know. And if you want to retweet some of the tweets about the content that's going out, it's a little ahead of me right now because we started late. But by all means, hashtag us and share the news. But look, in 2015, people watched television on average of 2 hours and 48 minutes a day. Wait till you see the other stats. But this is what we have today. You saw in the video the attention span of the adult now. I think they said 7 seconds. This said 8 seconds. It doesn't matter. You have seconds to grab somebody's attention before they move on to the next thing. seconds. And this is what scenario is. You know it, you see it. You've got, I think mom's the only one not on a device, but the TV's on. Everybody's got a device moving here. This is what we're dealing with. This is what we're trying to try. We're trying to get the attention of our customer, of our client. This is what we're competing with. So how do you compete with this? Well, you look at digital. Digital, online, social, you have to meet your customer where they are. That's the major thing. And digital is exploding faster than any of us imagined. Digital totals 80% of television ad spend in 2015. It's expected to reach $69 billion this year, $95 billion in 3 years. Digital video advertising has grown by more than a third year over year. Mobile is expected to be the fastest growing advertising segment this year. This is not 2 years down the road. This is not, oh, I'll think about it, because it's going to be a while before I need to deal with it. It's happening now. 1 out of every 6 minutes people on the internet are on Facebook. How many people checked their Facebook this morning before they even came here? Okay. How many, when they woke up, looked at their phone as soon as they woke up? Or used their phone as their alarm clock? Okay. Mobile disruption is already here. Look at these stats. And this is 2014. You already have more people on mobile, time spent on mobile, than on TV. And most times, what we're discovering is not only are people on their mobiles more, they're on their mobile while they're watching TV. So what we call the second screen. So while they're watching, they're buying on their mobile device. You're probably already doing it. How many times are you on QVC and buying it from your phone? You're not calling. You're on the app. So the social media GPS strategy. In three areas. I've adapted it, of course, a little bit. So global means it's a Google world. SEO still matters. If I have any SEO experts out there, usually I have a few, but SEO, search engine optimization. People still need to find you, and it does matter. Positioning. Mobile is no longer an option. Positioning. How are you going to find your client? How are you going to position your brand? How are they going to know where you are? And the system, your operating manual, your strategy, your blueprint. How are you going to create that so that you can have success? We don't have a choice. So we'll start with global. SEO and the digital marketing mix. The definition has changed. The definition has changed because back in the day, SEO, and these are the gurus, right, who used to do SEO. You know, it was about backlinks and about trying to get positioning in the back end through Google. Keywords were still important, but there was a lot more tech involved, a lot more of working with maybe your developer. You didn't have to worry so much about that. Today, search engine optimization is tied to Google in a different way because Google keeps changing their algorithm. Algorithms, for those of you who understand that term, are the mechanics behind what we call search results and feeds, like Facebook feeds, Twitter feeds. Algorithms determine what you see. And they're very complex, based in math, stuff I don't care to learn about. But what we need to know about it is how do we deal with those algorithms so that we are found, so that our business comes up if someone's looking for you. And Google, in their last update, put an emphasis on two things that changed the game: social media and content. Social media and content. And if you didn't pay attention to that, you need to. Because Google, when they're looking, when someone puts a search query in, those two factors make a difference in how you show up. The last piece of that is something Google did this past, in 2015, is where they put the emphasis on mobile. So now they put marks against you if your site's not mobile responsive. So getting found, I know, I'm going to date myself again. Who remembers those guys? We missed them. Wow, you actually missed them. I don't miss them. Now we use them for doorstops. Yeah. Or if you have a kid, make them sit higher. But that's the way it used to be. Not that they're not, you know, Yellow Pages are online now, so we still have them, but we don't have the books anymore, right? So they're no longer how we get found. Google, Bing, YouTube, Facebook, Siri, Cortana, that's how we're getting found. In fact, Bing is more important than you think. Amazon, Yahoo, Apple, Microsoft all have Bing as their default search engine. So they broker deals with Bing to use that. The difference is, when you do a search, we always assumed, right, it would go to your website, right? So if you're going to do a search, it's going to go to my website now, right? Well, here's how digital has changed that. Now you need a click-to-call number on your website. People want, when they're on their device, to be able to just hit the button and call immediately. Now it's going to an e-commerce site, Etsy, or a Shopify site that you have on your store. Or a map listing, right? You're on your device, and how many times have you said, where is, and the map comes up? Here I was searching for, I think, hotels in the Long Branch area. And it's specific to your location. What's showing up are location-based. We're going to talk more about that. Or it may go to your Facebook page. That's the difference now, because it's coming off your device. Now, technical SEO is still important. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because, number one, you don't need to spend a lot of time on this unless this is your business. But you need to know this is important, and you need to clean up the back end of your website. You need to do it. So this stuff here, robots, 301 directs, your web developer knows about it. Don't just say, hey, make sure all this is clean. Make sure we don't have problems. Make sure the load time on your website, because no one wants to wait. Remember, we have less than 8 seconds? If your website's not loading fast, they're going to move to the next one. No attention. Must be mobile responsive. You're going to hear me say that over and over until I'm a broken record, and get over it. It's going to happen. And implementation of social sharing. So again, you need to have your links to your social media buttons that you're currently using. Social sharing. You want people to share your information. You're going to find the importance of that later. Other stuff. Configuration and cross-referencing of blog and social accounts. This is, again, something your web person will probably help you with. Backlinking, again, making sure that you have your website listed on various other third parties. And your Google My Business listings. So keywords. That's another part of the search engine optimization game. Keywords. How many people have heard about keywords? Okay. Are we using keywords? How many people are using keywords? Okay, so you can't skip this step. Now, I've been counseling hundreds of small businesses for several years. Can't skip this step. People think they can get by and not do their keyword research. You have to do it. It's critically important to getting found. Critically important. In fact, we have a program on search engine optimization at the Small Business Development Center. I don't know when this one is taught, but if you go to our website, as Jacqueline mentioned, there's a whole program. It's taught by my counterpart, Roland Reinhart. Some of you have taken Roland's classes, I believe, on search engine optimization, so if you need to learn more about that. But keywords. So we're going to do a little exercise. You think you're going to get some homework, did you? We're going to get some work. So number one, first of all, when you do your keywords, you must put the hat of your customer on. Do not think as the business owner, because you're already not going to get it right. Bless you. You need to think about how your customer, if you're not sure, ask your customer. Ask people that you know. What are you looking for? How are you querying for my business? If you were going to find my business, what would you put in a search engine? What are you looking for? So what I want you to do, number one, is write down the main categories within your business. Okay? Main category. Top level. Think about your website. You know, do you offer a service? If you offer a service, what are things within the service that you offer? Example, one of my services is social media training, social media workshops. All right? I also do counseling, and I do consulting. I do a lot of things, but that's one of them. So think about all the different things that you offer. High-level categories. Then write down the terms or phrases that might fall under those categories, okay? So anyway, think about, again, how did the customer? How are they going to look for that? Social media training, social media workshops. So maybe I'm thinking social media workshops is my category. So someone's going to put in, well, I need a social media workshop to learn about social media. No. They're going to say, I need social media training. I wouldn't know this unless I do some research. Workshops, training, you wouldn't think it's a big difference, can make a huge difference. Here's an example. So the ASBDC, the America Small Business Development Center, their main categories will probably be new business, remember Jacqueline mentioned that, or business loans, or financing my business, marketing my business, entrepreneurship, right? You understand the high level? Now let's go to the next level. What are the phrases, if someone was looking at starting a new business, I'm starting a new business, what would I be putting in Google if I needed help? If I needed a service, what would I do? Maybe I'm going to say, how do I start a new business? How do I finance a new business? How do I market a new business? See the difference? So a keyword, key phrase, same thing. If I'm using keyword, I'm meaning phrases. Anymore, when we go to Google, how many of us even type one word in? Only one. Good for you. Most times we type in a phrase. I put whole paragraphs in anymore. I'm like, I need to know. And Google figures it out. Right? Google figures it out. So you want to look at it from that respect. All right, so this is an exercise. How many? I want you to start doing this. Top main categories. You're going to have 2 minutes. What are your top main categories and what are the phrases? Okay, who wants to share? Yes.
Well, I'm in a band, so I LLC the band, so we can start doing selling merchandise for websites, writing all the gear and stuff like that. So most of the stuff that I'm going right now is the only backline keywords to find us in Google sites, searches and stuff like that. So what I did right now is doing cross-referencing the band that we're a tribute to. So for us, it's we're named Rhyme and Reason, and Dave Matthews Band is who we're trying to gain their followers.
Okay.
And fans. So we bring like their scene to like a local scene. So right now I'm just like doing keywords like rhythm and blues, bass, drums, feels, bring people together, how to gain more fans. And there's a billion hashtags I can use. So.
Okay, but the keywords are, so if you had those keywords, what, how would you drill it down now to some phrases you could actually use in your content?
Well, the number one that I use is love, L-O-V-E. It's a certain phrase that they use in their concerts, because there's a sign that has been going around since like 1994. So it kind of turned into like a hashtag, L-O-V-E.
Okay.
And that's the number one thing that draws people to our website.
Okay, so you've already done some good research on your audience. You know what attracts them, and you've drilled down to that. So that's a good start. Let's get some ideas going. Now we're going to find out what's going to work for you. But you need to start somewhere. You need to come up with 5, 10, 20. Start somewhere. I kid you not, do not skip this step. This is so super critical to your website and to getting found. So where, how do you determine if those keywords will work for you? How do you determine if they're the right keywords? Google gives us a free tool. It's called Google AdWords Keyword Planner. Now, you do not have to buy ads to use this tool, but you do have to sign up. Okay? So you sign up for it. It's easy. Won't hurt you. You don't have to buy ads. But when you go to the planner and then you put your keyword in, I put in here, how to start a new business, right? That was the phrase that I was going for. And then it's going to show you the average monthly searches. You're going to know the volume. You don't need to worry about the bid or the competition as much right now because you're not buying ads. All you're looking for are people searching for this term. That's what you're looking for. Because you may, a perfect example is maybe I was thinking people were searching for social media workshops, and I found out they're not. They're searching for social media training. Okay? So why would I put social media workshops in there when they're looking for training? They're not gonna find me if I put workshops. So you want to use the Google AdWords Planner to help you determine if anyone's even looking for your key phrase. And what'll happen is it'll give you other suggestions of what other people are searching for. So that'll help you fine tune and tweak it. Because you may say, well, no one's looking for that, but they're looking for something similar and it's showing up and it's getting more traffic. So that may be the keyword you need to use. Does that make sense? Okay, so the starting point is just do the laundry list. Come up, brainstorm as many as you can, okay? Then go to the keyword planner and see what's working. Now, if you're still stuck, all right, if you're still like, I can't figure out what the right keyword is, I have some other suggestions. Anybody use Google Autocomplete? You go to Google and you start typing in and it starts dropping down and telling, okay? Do you know what that is? When it gives you all those search terms, these are the most common things people are searching for. That's why it's giving you the autocomplete. So that may help you. So if you go into Google and start typing in your phrase, see what drops down. You may discover something that you didn't realize. All right? Because this is what people are searching for. Now, caveat is make sure you log out. Number one, do not be logged into your Gmail or Google at all. So if you've been in the Keyword Planner, log out, clear your history, because this is specific to you. Google remembers in that browser. So you want to clear all that out so that you get a result, or go to someone else's computer or go use somebody else's device to see if you can get a different response. Because if you're using yours, it's going to remember what you're doing. All right, so just remember that. Everything's personal when it comes to Google. They're trying to get to find out what you want. And then the last one where you want to check is your Google Analytics. So Google Analytics, who knows what Google Analytics is? Okay, so a few people on this side. This side, we're not sure. Google Analytics is another free tool that Google provides so that you can look at what's happening in your website. All right, so your web developer, if you already don't have it installed on your website, you must get it installed. It's just a piece of code that goes into your website, and that piece of code will then be connected to your dashboard in Analytics. So you'll need to create that. You log in to your Analytics dashboard. It's not that scary. In fact, we have a whole course on how to do Google Analytics here. So if you need that, sign up for it. 3 hours on how to read your analytics, very important. But there's a piece in your analytics that relates to this. It shows you the keywords that people are searching to find your website. We're going to take questions later, sorry. So Google Analytics is the third place you want to look because you want to see what people are already using to find you. And maybe you can make some adjustments from that information. So all this information will help you. Okay, now you have this list, right? You've got the list, right? I'm trusting. If you meet with me one-on-one, by the way, what do you think I'm going to ask you for? So you better do this homework before you meet with me, because that's a good starting point for our conversation, all right? So by all means, what does this mean? Oh, by the way, I did make a little thing. This arrow here, sometimes I look at the ads that pop up too. That's another place. See what they're putting in their headlines for their ads? Sometimes that gives you just another idea of something that people are searching for, because people are paying for that. Okay, so you're going to incorporate these into your website. How do we do that? All right, we don't want to confuse Google. We don't want to confuse your customer. So we're going to take one of those key phrases per page. One per page. That's it. And this is where it needs to be. So again, if your web developer needs to help you with this as you're creating your content, that's the way it is. But you have to make this happen. It needs to be at least in the page title, the most important place, the page title, the very, very top, not the URL, the title. That's created when you create the page. What's your title? And also, though, in these two or three places, the URL, all right, that's the address across there, the header or an H1 tag, and that's important for Google, right? So a header would be the title of your actual page, but you have to use the code H1 in that title for it to show up as that way. Or the body content with actual paragraphs in your content itself. So that keyword phrase has to be at least in two of those three places. The whole phrase, what people will be searching for. Now, at least two of these four places, all right? The meta description, again, that's in the back end of it. It's in the source code, but many, if you're on a WordPress site, allow you to put that in with a plugin. I know this might be gibberish to some of you, but your web developer will help you, okay? But your meta description, I can't tell you how many websites I look at and there is no meta description. That meta description is important because it relates to what shows up in Google as well. I'm going to show you that in a second. Image alt tags. Did you know that Google can't read images? If you have lots of images, which we like pictures, right? We like lots of pictures. But if you do not put what's called an alt tag with your photo, Google can't read it. So if you're uploading a photo, again, I'm using WordPress as an example, but all website development tools have this. The photo, when you're actually uploading it, gives you a place, and you'll see alt tag. It's there. You just probably don't pay attention to it. You need to make sure that's populated, and that's an opportunity for you to put that key phrase in there, if it relates to the photo. Don't do it unless it relates to the photo, okay? But if it does, there's another opportunity. The site navigation link text. So again, remember I talked about that top navigation? So if you're even at a subpage, is a subpage labeled appropriately with that keyword or phrase? And then in content link. So again, in the content itself, it can be a link to another page. So it doesn't have to be in all these. If you do all of them, you do have to make some variations. There was a question here, do we need to have the same exact thing. If you're going to do it, at least in the ones that are mandatory, use the same one. You may have to use some variations because, again, it gets overload, and you don't want to end up spamming Google. You want it to be appropriate. Your web developer is the ones who's going to, and your SEO experts, and again, we have courses here, workshops here that can help you navigate that. Roland Reinhart will give you one-on-one counseling if you take his courses, so take advantage of that. So here's my example of how this looks. Everybody know Rook? We love Rook, all right? They're a client of the SBDC too. We love Rook. So in their particular website up here, I don't know if I can get this to work, no. That's their top navigation where it says Rook and it says shop, cold brew, story, press, locations. So they're optimizing for cold brew. That's their signature coffee, right? Cold brew. So they have it in their site navigation link text, correct? See that? They have it in their page title, cold brew. The first thing you see, then Rook Coffee. It's in their URL, rookcoffee.com/cold brew. It's in their H1 tag. So when I looked at their website, I looked at their page source. Sure enough, it was in their H1. And it was also in their meta and body content. Cold brew is a handcrafted concentrate, blah, blah, blah. So they had it in all the appropriate places. Totally optimized page for that. The other thing, though, see where it says page title and meta description? In your Google results, did you know that's what shows up? So if you want to optimize for people in Google results to click on it, you want to pay attention to make sure that it shows up and that this text is that meta description that you have crafted. If you have not created the meta description, or you put let your developer that created your site 5 years ago do something, and you haven't looked at it since then, that's what's showing up in search. You have complete control to change that. If you do not change it, it's going to automatically either pick up what's in your page source, or if there's nothing there, we'll pick up the first part of your first paragraph. But your first paragraph may not relate to, it may be something that you don't want in your meta description. People won't understand that if they're doing a search. That's why the meta description is even more important. Does that make sense? I'm getting good shake? Okay. We're going to move on. Enough about keywords. So we're still in the Google world and global. Local search. Local search is key. We know that because of these devices. Everything comes from this, right? Everything. So you need to optimize for local search. And the first place you need to do that is by claiming your Google My Business page. It used to be called Google Local, then it was Google Places, now it's Google My Business. I don't care what they call it, it doesn't matter. You have to claim this page. How many here have claimed their Google My Business page? A few. Okay, if you haven't, then you need to do that. Here's why. All right? This is how search is going to work. So if you have a brick and mortar, if you have an actual address, some of us are home-based, I know that, we don't want our address out there, but those of us that have addresses that we want people to find us, it matters in what's called the local stack listings. Right? You've seen that before, right? You do a search and you see the maps and you see, well, Google changed that on us too this past year. We used to have 7. Now you get 3. Even more tough to get on that list, right? So even more important for you to make sure you're optimized for local search because of that. So the first thing you want to do when you complete your listing is make sure your website, you have the correct category, and that you have some reviews. Reviews matter in who's showing up here. Reviews are going to matter in pretty much any of these now. You're going to hear me talk about reviews a lot more too. Reviews matter, so you need reviews. If you notice these all have 5, or, you know, they all have a lot of stars that are showing up here. So you need to ask some of your customers to give you Google Plus reviews. Go to Google and give us some reviews. Get a handful. Get it started. Now, the other important thing is that how this relates is if I am in here in Lincroft and I'm looking for something to eat and I go onto my phone, I'm typing in restaurants, I just want restaurants. I don't even put in Lincroft. It's already going to determine where I am. It's already going to say, you're here. Here's what's close to you. It's going to pull up what's in my vicinity. So that's where you come in place. If someone's looking for you and they're in your neighborhood, you want them to show up. Okay? Now, one really cool thing about Google My Places, and this is something newer because it wasn't there last time I looked. Every time I go into some of these, something new shows up. There is an immense amount of data that you can find out about your listing. I was working with one of our restaurant clients a little while ago, and we went into their Google My Places site, and we could find out how many people clicked on the directions link. How many people clicked on the click to call and called them from their Google listing? There was data there, so you'll know if this is working for you. That's important. People want to get you fast. They don't want to wait. Remember? 7 to 8 seconds. Or they're going to the next one. So the other place we need to optimize for local search is your website. Number one thing. Number one thing, must be mobile responsive. Doesn't necessarily have to be a mobile website. You can create a mobile website. You can. You don't have to do that. Right now, you can be mobile responsive. That's different. So you can have the same website. An important factor of this, again, for local search, that's what we're concentrating on. Make sure that your city or town is in the page title and descriptions, along with the service you offer. So if you want to optimize for local search, in that page title, maybe if we were going to say, if Rook had one location, Cold Brew/Rook/Lincroft, New Jersey, in that page title. Doesn't mean it's in there. header or in their but that piece will help with the local search. Does that make sense? So fine-tuning that. Also make sure it's on your pages where it's appropriate, either in the footer on every page or on your contact page. And please, 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 if you are a local business, make sure it's on your homepage. How many of you have gone to a homepage looking for a phone number and it wasn't there? Okay? Don't do that. Because what's going to happen? They're going to find the next one. Right? They're going to go to the next one. So make sure your phone number and your address are on your homepage if you want people to find you. Also, embed a Google map. If you haven't done that already, how many of you like to go to the map when you go, if you're looking for directions, right? You go to their site and you go to the map and you click on it and you find out where it is. Well, do that for your customers. Let them find you easily. In addition, add text, because Google will also pick up on the text. So make sure the text directions are there as well. That'll help. Again, optimizing for local, third-party sites. So what are some third-party sites I'm talking about? Ones we're also familiar with? Yelp, TripAdvisor, the Yellow Pages, still valuable. Facebook, other social media sites, these are all third party. So you want to make sure that you have all your information listed there appropriately as well. Okay? There's my hot tip is just do a Google search on your company name. How many of you have Googled your company name ever? Few, not many. If you've never Googled your company name, Google it. You should be Googling it probably once a month, easily. Once a month. Reason you want to, number one, see where you are right now. You're doing an assessment. Where am I right today? If I start doing all these improvements, you're going to start seeing the shift and the change. When I started out, I did not own the first page of Google when you search for my company, trust me. My company name, LK, is also a sink and a plumbing supply company. Okay? So I had a little bit of work to do. Now I own that page. If you Google my company name, I own that page. And what I mean by that is pretty much 9 of the 10 results will be about my company. Every once in a while, something else will slip in. But I continually work to keep that presence. That's what you want to do. You don't want them to find anybody else. You want them to find you. And by you being like, well, maybe the Yelp address thing will come up, or maybe TripAdvisor will come up. You know, because these particular third-party sites are working very hard to optimize so they show up. So take advantage of that. Take advantage of that. If you have just your name, you know, if your company is your name or you're a sole proprietor and it's your name, LinkedIn does a phenomenal job of making sure you show up first in search, as long as your name is in your URL. Okay? So you want to go to these different sites. Do a Google search, see what shows up. That's your first step. Go to all those sites first. Claim the listing. Again, you just have to say, hey, I'm the business owner. This is me. You may have to verify it with some information. They'll call you up and say, are you the business owner? And then you make sure the information's complete. Your website's in there. Your phone number's correct. Upload some photos. Anything that you can to complete that listing 100%. And make sure it has good content, so that people, when they if they show up there, get what they need. Now, here's a big tip that I learned actually from our website guy, Roland, about your name, address, and phone number. Your name, address, and phone number need to show up exactly the same way everywhere across the web. Everywhere. Or Google gets confused, and it pushes your ranking down. Everywhere. It's called NAP, N-A-P, name, address, phone number. So here's your example. This is the way it's on our letterhead, okay? So maybe on the far left, that's the way it's on our letterhead. But then somebody, when they created our website, bless you, didn't put the LLC on there and abbreviated the suite. And somebody who decided to put it on my Google My Business page spelled out street and then put the 800 in parentheses. Every one of those things will mark against you. So come up with one way, and use it consistently across everywhere you are on the web. And go look to see where it's not done that way and fix it. Does that make sense? So, getting off the G, your global actions, your website, the technical stuff. Identify and add your keywords, that's your homework. And make sure you have a mobile responsive website. Those three things you must do. Optimizing for local search, make sure that you claim your Google My Business page. Make sure you go to your third party sites, claim them, optimize them. Make sure your name, address, and phone number is the same across everywhere on the web. Positioning. Mobile is no longer an option if you want to be found. I see some tablets here. I see some computers. And everyone has one of these, right? Anyone here not have a cell phone? Look around. Let me say it again. Anyone here not have a cell phone? Okay. Made my point. In fact, how many of you got a text message reminding you to be here today? See how important that is? So when you leave your cell phone behind. Right? Because 79% of us is with us everywhere, correct? How many of you like drove away and said, oh, my cell phone's on the counter, and went back to get it? Because we can't live without this device. So, as a customer, as a consumer, as just an individual, if you already know that about yourself, as a business owner, what do you need to do? Because mobile is personal. Everybody has one. It's pervasive. It's with you all the time. It's the last thing you look at before you go to sleep. It's the first thing you look at when you wake up in the morning. Scary. But that's what it is. And you go to a younger generation, it's scarier. It's scarier, right? And it provides the opportunity for proximity. Remember, proximity. Local, reaching people. 95% of mobile users look up local information on their phones, and the primary functions are calling or visiting a business. They're using their phone to find you. Are you showing up for them? So why this emphasis on mobile? 1 month to sell 1 million iPads. By 2020, 10 billion mobile devices globally, 10 billion. There are parts of the world that do not have running water, but people have a mobile device. Okay? That's how pervasive. Mobile will command almost 25% of overall e-commerce by next year. A quarter of e-commerce is going to be done from a phone or a tablet by next year. Always on, anytime, anywhere. This is the device. So we talked about how do I make sure my website is responsive? Because we know we have to do that, right? Yeah. It's important. Google, our friend, helps you again. Because when Google made the change in their algorithm and started making black marks against the sites that weren't mobile responsive, they said, well, I guess we need to show people if they're responsive enough or not. So there's the link. Go to that link when you leave here. Before you see me, if you go for one-on-one counseling, what am I going to ask you? Did you check? You put it in your website URL in. Of course, I did a nice check for the MOSBDC, and it came up. Yes, you're mobile friendly. So if you get that nice, yay, awesome, you're good. But unfortunately, what I find is most people get this. Okay, so this is one typical scenario you may get as a result. All right, it's not mobile friendly. Page appears not. Text is too small. Mobile viewpoint not sent. Links too close together. But at least it's telling you what's wrong. Okay, so at least it lets you know, do you need to do a complete overhaul of your site? or are there a couple minor things you need to change? So that'll give you some guidelines on what you need to do. So when we talk about mobile marketing as a business owner, what can you do? So how do you use this device now? Because everyone's got one. How do you implement that into your strategy and your plan? So mobile website's the first thing you need to have. I'm going to say that a gazillion times, I know. But location-based marketing. Okay, location-based marketing. What does that mean? Offering coupons, offering incentives, using Facebook local. Look for ways when people are pulling you up locally to incentivize them to come to you. That's location-based. Making sure, of course, you're optimized locally across the board. All the things we just talked about. QR codes are still relevant in different ways. It's great to put QR codes on your countertops so people can scan them to find your pages, find your social media. So there are ways you can use QR codes. SMS, which is texting. Again, many of you got the text. So there are many services out there where you, if you can get people's mobile numbers and they opt in, you can text them. Of course, mobile display ads and banner ads, now we're seeing that, especially if you're on any free app or free site, you're gonna get ads. But that's an opportunity for you as well. It's not just the big guys. Mobile paid search, apps, you can create your own app, an application. You know, we all use apps, right? We all have apps on our phones. So depending on your business, it might be a good move for you to create an app. May not be. You just have to determine if that, depending on what the app is, will there be a use for it? But that's another way to serve your customer. And the mobile wallet. How many of you have gone to the grocery store? I mean, Wegmans has it. I've seen a few of the big box stores. I think Macy's, where you can Apple Pay. You can just swipe your phone. Have you seen it? It's coming. And it's coming bigger and bigger and bigger. So there are opportunities as that grows, maybe not today, but keep in mind that there are ads and opportunities when people are doing that. Because right now, you know, you go and you get all these receipts, you get all these other information. Maybe there's an opportunity for you to get ads in there too. So keep in mind. So some resources for you. I'm not going to go through them. I just want to throw them in. If you're looking for a text, I do not endorse anyone. Okay, so I haven't used these all personally. I did some research on your behalf, but clearly I know some of them, people who do use these and find success. And then your mobile ads. I mean, Millennial Media is a site you can go to find out more about mobile ads. And then all the other sources. So your action items for mobile. Number one, you're going to find out if your website's friendly. You're going to immerse yourself in mobile. So most times when I work with small businesses, social media in general scares a lot of people. It's getting better. But now mobile's going to be like, are you kidding me? One more thing. If you're not comfortable using it, it's going to be hard for you to implement it for your business. So you need to get more comfortable doing it. Now you're already doing it in some ways, I'm sure. Some of you are nodding your heads when I say how many are using apps already to buy things or whatever. So some of us may be already using some shopping and things of that nature. Start doing a little bit more. Start getting more comfortable with it. You know, check in on Foursquare or Facebook. You know, when you go to places, check in. Now, many of us like our privacy in Facebook. I do hear that a lot, so maybe checking in is not, but Foursquare is easier. That's why I put that up there. If you're not familiar with Foursquare, we'll talk about that one-on-one, but that might give you an opportunity to start using it if you don't want to do Facebook. You know, use a shopping app if you're not already using it. Use a voice search. You know, we all have where we can talk to our phones. Use it more. Play with it. For search, for finding things, not for what you're normally doing it. You know, experiment, see what shows up. You know, in your neighborhood, ask about where you are and see if you're showing up. You know, see, you know, for a local search. And of course, you can download a mobile payment app. So Starbucks has it. There are a few different payment apps where you actually use your phone to pay. You know, you load your card into the app. Are we familiar with that? If you're not using it, try it. Use it. Get used to it. So the last thing is you want to make sure you know which tactics you're going to implement. So we're talking about overall strategy now, remember? Overall strategy. What of the things I just discussed in the mobile world can you actually do? You can't do it all, I get it. I've kind of thrown the fire hose at you so far. But pick what's going to work for you maybe right now and 6 months from now, a year from now. What can you implement down the road? That's what we're looking for. I understand it can be overwhelming. Don't let it overwhelm you. Instead, get something moving ahead. Last, your system, your strategy. What's the end result, and how are you going to get there? That's the most important thing. Back to the blueprint. Define your target audience. Here's another thing that I meet with many, many business owners, and they don't know who their market is. When I ask them, who's your target market? What do you think I get? Everybody. Everybody. No. Potentially, maybe everyone could buy your product or service. I get that. But that's not your market. You need to figure that out. Identify your brand personality. It's a little bit different because this is social. So you may not have thought about it in this way, but your brand has a personality. I have a personality. People who know me understand what my personality is for my brand and how I interact. You have the same thing. Your company has the same thing. Figure out what that is. We're going to talk more about that. You need to look at your current social media and do an assessment. Know what your objectives are. What's your endpoint? What platforms will you use? How you're going to measure results? And then create your plan. So your target market. Number one, have you done this already for your customer or your client? Have you done? I'm here seeing some nods. Yes. Who hasn't done this yet? You can be honest. It's okay. No, it means you have to do it. No big deal. If you haven't done it, now you can have more than one customer. Something else. You don't have to be. You can maybe have two or three different customers. It's okay. But define each one. Figure out how old are they? Are they male or female? What's their age range? And how much money do they make? What do they do for a living? Are they married, single, in a relationship? What's their education? You know, do you have a Hispanic market that you're working with? Things like that nature. Think about that. Write it down. These are not things you keep in your head. I hate that when people say, well, it's in my head. Then you go to the psychographics. And why am I going this level? Why do you think this is so important? Because we're talking about social media. We're going beyond a conversation with you and your customer in your place of business or in your relationship. We're trying to reach other customers. So you need to know more about them and reach them at that level. So you have to figure out, what do they like? What do they dislike? You know? What do they watch on TV? What magazines or websites would they read? What are their values? All this relates to you. It goes back to your company culture and your brand. You want to match. You already have customers that are like that. So go look at your current customer base. It's a great place to start, right? And see how they relate to you. And see what their psychographics are. This becomes extremely valuable when you move into social. And it becomes even more valuable when you go to advertising on social. Because social gives you a whole other opportunity of actually using this information that you can't do in other advertising. Now, your particular product or service. Let's dive in even deeper. Okay? So it's not just about the top level. We're going as deep as we can. You really want to have a picture of what this person looks like. So that when you're creating your ads, when you're creating your content on social media, when you're figuring out what do I talk about, that person's image shows up. That's the person that, think about your best customer. That person has to show up in front of you because social is 1-to-1. That's why I'm honing on this, 1-to-1. You're not talking to the masses. Think about how you use social media for yourself. You're reading it. You don't have a group of you reading it at the same time. So they're talking to you directly. Does that make sense? So that's the way you have to think about this. It's a little different. So what features appeal to them? Again, this is going to help you create the content. You know, what do they like? You know, when do they use it? Or when do they hire you? You know, is there a certain way they use it? These are all things that will help you understand your customer better and understand how you can create your content. When in doubt, look at your competition. Right? If you're not quite sure where to start, look at your competition, look at their customers. And if you want more of them, how do you reach them? Who are they and how do I get them? Right? Another exercise. Couldn't get away. So who's your target market? Give it its own persona or name it, okay? So it makes it easier for you, instead of saying customer A, say John Q, Debbie, you know, give them a name. Why not? So create your personas, your customer personas. This is your homework. You're getting a minute to do this, okay? And then you're going to create an identifying statement for each. I'm going to give you some examples. So take a few minutes and write down who is your customer. So if you have several target markets, create more than one. So if you're coming, you're identifying statement. So once you've identified this, this is maybe what you might want to write. A single male in his late 20s renting an apartment in San Francisco and making more than $20,000 a year. I mean, $200,000. $20,000, they couldn't even live in San Francisco. $200,000 is tough in San Francisco right now. They're like one of the top housing booms in the country. A married mother of two in Nevada that is a stay-at-home parent has a total family income of less than $40,000 per year. See how specific these are? See how you get a picture when you read that? That's what we're trying to create, the picture in your head. Because that's who you have to talk to in social. Create the picture. A professor who drives an old Volvo, who's very intelligent, very sophisticated, but not a conspicuous purchaser. Now, one of these is an actual identifying statement for a company. Which one do you think it is? What? Anybody know? One of these is actually an is that statement that a company uses for their customer. We hope. The married mother of two. Anybody else want to give a guess? The single male. The single male? Somebody says the professor. Okay. Everybody picked one. The professor. Trader Joe's. That's Trader Joe's customer. How do you like that? That's how they create their, you know, who would have thought? But now that you know Trader Joe's, doesn't that make sense? Yeah. Okay. See how you need to create this? All right. Your brand personality. You probably haven't thought about this in this context, but you do have a way you convey that you can't communicate. And that's what attracts people to you and your brand and your company. You're not for everybody. You aren't. But there are people that will be attracted to you and that want to do business with you and want to buy your product or service. But you got to know what that personality is, because that matters when it comes to social. You need to connect human characteristics. I mean, working for those lawyers, try and be human with that. They wanted that corporate veil. Doesn't work in social. It just doesn't. You have to drop the corporate veil. You have to be a person. And you have to communicate on that level. All right? So you got to think about, how does your brand behave? Some introspection. Look at your company. If you have several employees, or look at yourself. How do you interact with your customers? Why do they like you? Why do they work with you? This is what differentiates you from everybody else. You can have the same product or service, and many of you do have competition. There is no competition if you have a personality behind your brand. There are lots of people who do social media training and workshops out there. It's a growing field. It's awesome. Lots of people need help. I don't have a problem with that. But not everybody wants to work with me. That's okay too. But certain people want to work with me because they know me, they know how I interact, they know how my brand personality. Okay? No problem. You need to create that so people are attracted to you. And it's already happening. You just need to discover it. Bless you. Discover it. Find it. All right? Because this is really going to be the key to your content creation interaction. It really is. People say, I don't know what to write. Figure it out. This will help you. Here's an example. Call Ruby. This is an answering service. This is what this is. It's an answer. They answer the phone. They're calling them, virtual receptionist. An answering service. They're taking your phone calls for you. But what a personality they have. This is, we make our mark by practicing wowism. Okay? They're out in Oregon. This is their website. This is their Facebook page. Look how fun. People, cheerful, friendly, happy. Deliver a perfect mix of friendliness, charm, can-do attitude, professionalism. That's a brand personality. Does that evoke personality to you? Do you get the feeling of who these people are just by looking at their photos and seeing that? Okay? You don't have to be that, but what is your personality? Figure it out. Your current situation. This is a lot of work, so we're not going to be able to do that in an exercise, but by all means, if you meet with me one-on-one, guess what we're going to look at? Where are you now? Back to GPS. You got to know where you are now before you know where you're going to go. So you need to do a hard assessment. And everybody's in a different place right now. That's one of the bigger challenges for anyone teaching this is it used to be everyone was pretty much a beginner. When I started doing this 8 years ago, everybody was just figuring it out. Now everybody's in different levels. When we first opened up the questions, some people are using social media very successfully. Some of you are still figuring it out. It's okay. Just do it. But where are you now? What social media are you using? Did someone come into your business 3 or 4 years ago, create a website for you, say, hey, you have to have every social media platform and we're going to create it for you and we're going to put it into the package, and you go, okay. And suddenly you have social media on every platform and you're not using it. Right? So you have links on your website to go to Twitter and Facebook and Pinterest, but you're not using any of them. People click on it and it goes to a page that somebody created 3 or 4 years ago and there's nothing there. That's not helping you. That's not helping you. But you need to write that down. You need to know, what do you currently have going on? How are you using social? Whatever level you're at now, we're going to look at where do we take you to the next level. That's the whole point. Because there's always more. There's always more. But that doesn't matter. You just need to do it. You need to get to that next step. All right, so current assessment. You want to do all these things. Look at what your content's doing. Look at how it's being used. And know where you're at now. Define your objective. Why are you using social? Did anybody really think about this when they first signed up to use social media? One person. But, you know, because somebody told me I had to do it, that's probably the biggest reason, right? Well, somebody said I have to be on Facebook. Somebody said I have to be on LinkedIn. Whoever somebody is, I have no idea how they had so much influence on you. But you did it, right? But now you need to think about why. What's your objective? Now, early on, if you're beginning, you probably need just to build brand awareness, right? Maybe you need to just get some relationships with your customers and clients, or better understand your clients, or increase website traffic, right? So you can't do all of these things. This list is a laundry list for you to explore where you need to set some objectives, not to do them all. Eventually, yes, we're here, right? We're in business. This is not an exercise just for fun. This is an exercise so that we make money. So eventually you want to get leads and sales. But that's not where you might be right now. Someone who's more advanced may be at that point. If you're just beginning, you're up there somewhere. Pick one or two, okay? Pick one or two and set those as your objectives for wherever you are based on your assessment. Then at least now we can create the roadmap. So now here's where you are now, right? GPS, here's where I want to go. I want to build brand awareness. All right, Lisa, let's figure out how we get there. Now it makes sense. Now you know what you're doing and not what you're driving for. You're not just endlessly posting stuff and you don't know why. So, your key objectives. All right, come up with a statement. Make it measurable, time-based, right? That's what we are. So, I want to rank at the top of Google for the keyword Italian restaurant in Freehold, New Jersey in 3 months. Can you do that? Yes. Sure you can. I want to get 100 new leads a month by driving traffic to my website opt-in form. You can do that. That's something measurable, and you'll know the tactics you need to put in place to make that happen. I want to post content on social media daily and track your likes, comments, and shares for 1 month. Maybe that's someone who's more in the beginning because they're not used to posting daily. They've been posting once a week, once a month. And they're not even tracking their metrics to see if they're getting any engagement. So you're going to start paying attention more. That's a very good goal or very good objective to get started. Okay. In the interest of time, because we have a whole jam-packed second half, and we probably all need a bio break at this point, you need to decide what your key objectives are going to be and what you're going to measure. Okay? You want to be specific. So again, if you meet with me one-on-one, these are some of the things we're going to go over. Okay? Because you need to identify where you want to be. Now we have clarity on what we need to do. Without this, we have no clarity. We don't know. All right? So that's an exercise for you to do maybe during the break. Okay. So we talk about measuring ROI, return on investment. So that's the bottom line. If you or someone you hire or someone on your staff invests all this time, maybe money, effort, into creating a social media strategy, what's your return? You need to know what that is. That's part of that objective. You need to know, was it worth it? How many of you know if it's worth it right now? Few. Some of you are like, okay, I'm doing it, but geez, how do I know if anything's working for me? Well, because you don't know what you're measuring against. That's the biggest thing. So in the beginning, you're starting with followers. You're looking at, okay, I need to get likes. In fact, I mean, people need to know you're there, right? You're building that brand awareness. So that's a good place to start, making sure people are interacting with you. And then you're looking for the engagement. Engagement. Likes and shares, comments, that's engagement. Views to videos, that's engagement. Referral traffic, all right? That means people are sharing it. That means people are pointing back to you. They're referring back. You want that. You want to grow that audience. You know, that's the beautiful thing about social and the web is the viral effect. People like to share stuff. You can ask them. Conversions is where you're finally getting into what you talk about. Money hits the road, you know. Am I really making progress where I'm converting someone to do an action? To do an action. So it may be you're collecting email addresses. Okay? So that's a conversion. They actually put the email address in. So 20 people saw it, 2 people gave me an email address. Or they actually purchased something. You know, the end result is yes, they bought the product. Okay? Make sense? And the last thing is the actual sale. So overall, as we wrap it up and take a break. Number one, get found. All right? If you're not getting found, there's no point. And mobile is it. You need mobile. So you want to optimize your website and optimize your online presence. Both. You want to embrace mobile. It's the new game in town. We all have it. Everyone here has a mobile device. If that's not enough for you to realize that you have to embrace it, I don't know what is. So use it personally. Look how you're going to integrate it into your business. Even in a small way, don't be afraid of it. Then you got to get your foundation started. Do your assessment. Know where you are. Get clarity and specific, and then create your plan of action. Yes. Good job. All right, we're going to take a break for about 10 minutes.